That light is crazy. It's,
I know. We have a brand new camera.
Wait, never looked older. Why? Isn't that Bomer the show? Is it the meanest show?
Should we just do this in the dark?
Turn off that damn light.
Okay.
We didn't do any dress rehearsal.
Well, the problem is we can't really do.
Well, the problem is my age.
But it's like at this point we don't care what the questions are. We're gonna just quickly change.
God.
The light.
All right, I'm gonna talk. Okay, everyone, hi. So I'm Seth. This is James.
Hi, I'm James Wesley. This is my husband Seth Rudetsky. Welcome to Stars in the House.
Fix the light. No more shattering.
Fix the light.
So. Wait, worse? Actually, that's fine. I look like 60 as opposed to 73.
The light is actually much better on you, Seth, than it is me.
No, we're both monsters. Anyway, this is a show that we do twice a day, 2 p.m. and 8 p.m. Every single day, we do it live, and people are watching all over the world. I just saw someone write.
Don't even start with those comments. You know what happens? You put a comment up, and then they fly by, Seth.
I know. Well, I just saw someone's watching in Greece where it's 3 a.m. in the morning. So the point is, we watch all over the world because it's literally live right now. And normally, we've been doing this. This is the end of our seventh week.
The beginning of the seventh week.
We've been raising money every single day for the Actors Fund.
It's a big shout out to the Actors Fund.
Yes.
We have raised.
The Actors Fund, by the way, is for everybody in show business.
Right.
Actors, just, singers, dancers, crew members, behind the scenes, in front of the camera.
Any professional in the performing arts. But so far, that's what the show has done up till today. Today is the exception to the rule. But up to this point, we have raised $275,300 for the Actors Fund, thanks to Stars in the House viewers. That's right. Today is a little bit different.
Yeah, there's another fundraiser of the Actors Fund happening at the same time.
That's right.
So we wanted to split charities. So the Actors Fund is happening on the Actors Fund YouTube channel. On Stars in the House YouTube channel, we have a very special charity tonight. The Trevor Project, which originally began because of that amazing movie Trevor by James Lacine. Amazing movie. If you've never seen it, you have to see it. And it's basically a suicide hotline for teens, for gay, lesbian, questioning teens. It's a brilliant organization, and we're raising money for it tonight.
And midway through the show, of course, you're here, I know, for a white collar reunion.
Yeah.
But midway through the show, we are going to have the head of the Trevor Project here to talk with us for a little bit about why the Trevor Project is more important now than ever. Seth, if you pull that too far,
you know what? You set up the lights.
I get to be out.
Oh, dial up rotary phone.
That's right.
Hey, listen, we want you to donate tonight. So before we start, we're going to just tell you how to donate. Right.
Well, it's right there on the little scroll. You'll see White Collar Reunion. Then it says donate at thetrevorproject.org/starsinthehouse.
Wow, that's complicated. Really?
Well, or you can go, if you're watching this live, you can go to starsinthehouse.com and donate.
Ah.
See, that's really because so many people watch it, Seth, after it's done
okay.
On their live.
So look, I'm going to just put this up for a second. Here's, you guys watching live right now, go to starsinthehouse.com, and then you're going to get a receipt from Trevor Project.
That's right.
Send it to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. I'm going to email those names to Matt, and he's going to read them as Neil in full character.
Wow.
So once you donate, forward the receipt you got to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. I'm going to then send a list to Matt, and he's going to read them as a criminal.
Oh my gosh.
Well, we're covered criminal.
Anything to make money for the Trevor Project.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here's the other thing.
Yes.
Before we continue, because I know we have a lot of new viewers, this platform that we use in order for us to be able to stream out to Facebook and to YouTube and to Periscope.
It's not Zoom.
Twitter.
Everything's
in
Zoom.
It isn't Zoom, but it allows us to do that. But the limitation for now is that we can only have up to five cast members on at a time.
Yeah.
So
it's called streamer.com. We love it.
And they're great.
But we can't have every single person in the cast. So we're going to divide up the show. So no having a panic attack. Where is Willie?
Yeah,
whatever it is. No panic attacks.
Yes.
Everyone's going to be here. That's
guessing. Promise. Okay.
Matt Bomer cannot make it. Everyone else will be here.
Actually, everyone is here because Matt Bomer. It's always one in the
one
bunch.
Cast member.
It's always one cast member. And for this, it was Matt Bomer. And he said yes right away. And we said, what about the Trevor Project? Because he and his husband Simon were going to be honored by the Trevor Project.
Yeah,
and that's
quarantine.
Been postponed. But we can, I know that Matt can talk more about it.
Don't worry about one in the cast.
Yes,
is that he organized the whole thing.
So
this whole thing happened because of Matt Bomer.
Right.
So exactly. We feel bad that he can't be here. What? Same joke?
So not true. Sorry.
Okay, so we're going to bring up our first group, right?
You bring them on, Seth.
I don't remember who's in the
here we go. We have it written down. We do not have cue cards.
Do you want me to do the clicking?
This. You want to do that? Here, I'll hold
okay,
that
start with
you.
Tim.
Actually,
so
the lighting is better.
Tim is here. So the officer, Tim DeKay. Hi, Tim.
Hi, guys. How are you?
Yeah, oh, wow. You're not in your suit. Okay, who else?
We have
Tiffani.
Tiffani.
Hi, Tiffani.
Hi.
And then we have Sharif. Don't like it. Where is Sharif?
Far left, Seth. Right under us. There we go.
Yes. Hey. Hi, Sharif. And then
I guess he just showed up, so he decided to make it. You want to bring on?
Yeah, and actually, Matt's in full. He's literally in his costume. So, look, I mean, he's literally dressed.
Hey, everybody.
Hi.
Hey, Matty.
We're so excited you guys are here. So I would love you guys to tell us who you play on the show. Oh, why am I echoing? Or why is someone repeating everything I say? Anyway, I'm going to tell you who you guys play on the show, and please, God, tell me your audition story. Tim, hit it.
Oh, I play Special Agent Peter Burke. And I got to say, Matt and I talked about wearing suits for this. And then everybody joined in. We thought, should everybody be in costume? And so, of course, everybody just started joking. And we all cracked up. And at about 4:30, I texted Matt, I'm confused. Am I going to wear my suit or just a T-shirt? And I didn't hear from him. So I feel bad. I should have showed up in my suit.
Tim, you chickened out.
No, I didn't. You know what? I can go quickly change right now. It would take me 5 seconds. No.
Can you do it right here?
It's fine.
We'd lose donations. People would say they want their money back. I play Special Agent Peter Burke, and I was a guy who said, we need Neil Caffrey to be a criminal informant. And so I kept this short, eventually long leash on him.
Hold on.
He gave me information.
Yeah. No, Matt said, I would like to be a criminal informant and help you. You did not come up with the idea. Do not take credit for me.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. You're quite right. You're quite right. Never disagree with the host. That's what my parents told me a long time ago. Never disagree with them. So you're quite right.
I'll take it. And how did you get the gig?
You know, I went through the normal process. I remember reading with Matt, and you know, it was a chemistry read, and I went in there and we read together, and it was like that. And I walked out and I thought, oh, I think I got this. I did, which you don't always feel as an actor, as you know. And so, yeah, it was one of those great moments where I thought, oh, this could be something.
Mm-hmm. Matt, do you remember the audition? And were you like, that guy's not going to get it?
Yeah.
No, I actually felt exactly the same. It was the second Tim left the room, I turned to everybody and I said, it has to be him. There was just something about the spontaneity and the way we played off of each other that, I don't know, it felt like something I'd want to do every day for 6 years.
Aww.
And so, yeah. I think I immediately approached you. I think I ran outside to you and was like, this has to
you
be
him. You did.
I wasn't game at all about it. I didn't have a good poker face. I was just like, yes.
It's true. And it made me feel I was doing a New Adventures of Old Christine. I was doing an arc on that show, and I went back there, and they all said, how'd it go? I think I got it, because Matt Bomer said, it's gotta be you. And so I thought, yeah, gotta be me.
Matt, how did you get it? Was the role written for you, or did you do this audition?
Oh my God, no, not even close. I mean, it wasn't a cattle call when I initially went in, but there were a lot of people up for the role, and I just kept making my way through the process, and the casting director, Gail Pillsbury, thankfully, was really in my corner from the get-go, as was the creator, Jeff Easton, but they had wanted someone who was in their 40s and British at the time, and so I really had kind of an uphill battle. And they actually made me test twice for the role. They made me screen test twice for it.
Wow.
But thankfully, Jeff was really in my corner, and he was saying, you know, these are just the rings you have to go through, and it's going to be fine. And we kept working on the material, and it all worked out okay.
Hey, Matt, is it one of those things when you read the script that you were like, this is the perfect role for me, even though it said 40s and British?
It didn't say 40s in British. I didn't find that out until well into the audition process. But I know, you know, it's so rare that I read a script and I think, oh, I think I can bring something to this that's really unique. And I did have that feeling from the first time I read this script. There was something about Jeff Easton's voice and the way I understood the rhythms of the characters and the tone. I got the tone of the show right away. And so yeah, there was something special from the first time I read the script.
Oh, wow. So you don't have to do a screen test. Blimey, with a British accent, love.
He kept calling me governor. And I didn't know what that was about. All right.
Good to know.
Mercy was high class and it was Cockney. I mean, it was all.
Yeah, it was. Yes. But just you ended up magic. Somewhat in Liverpool/Cockney. It was good.
You were cuddly in. All right, Tiffani, how did you get the job? Well, first of all, who do you play and how did you get the job?
Oh, I play Elizabeth Burke, Mrs. Burke, of course. And mine was also long process. They actually had me go the distance. And then they said I was too young, which that never happens in my career.
Well, that's nice.
And then I guess they continued looking at women, and then they brought me back, and I went right to a screen test, a chemistry read with Tim, and it was love at first sight.
It was.
Yep.
I found this sweet clip when Neil, you're sort of like Zelig. You're constantly just like Zelig, you know that movie? Like you're just constantly in a place, like no one knows how you get there. Matt. You're just constantly appearing. So this is when you first meet Tiffani and you're just like in Tim's house.
I remember it like it was yesterday.
I remember it.
She's an amazing wife. Yeah, I like her. Get off my couch.
Honey, we're just chatting.
Chatting? How did you get here? Cab. You activated your tracker. You're in my house, on my couch, with my wife.
Oh, hey, sexy mom. Honey,
you're petting my dog.
Did you really put Elizabeth under surveillance before you asked her out? Peter, I underestimated you.
You told him.
Well, he said he wanted to make sure that I wasn't seeing anybody else. Honey, I think it's cute.
I think it's adorable.
I'm putting you back in prison.
Wow, taking it back to the pilot, y'all.
Wow.
And do you remember it started snowing outside that day?
Yeah, it was snowing. Yeah.
It was snowing in Brooklyn that day. Yeah.
It's such a great tone, though, because it's not a comedy, but it's so comedic, and everyone plays that line so well. Everyone is so funny, but they're not shticky.
Right.
They're not me.
Because we also were having a good time.
Yeah,
we were, and Jeff Easton wrote it, too. I think Matt said something to that earlier about the rhythm. So if you hopped on his words correctly, you could ride them right through that fine line of comedy and drama.
And I felt like the whole collaboration from the get-go was very much of the improv world of a yes and. Nobody was ever cutting people off. It was always, how can we make this spontaneous and what can we bring to it and add to it? And the writers were so open to our input. And it was a really collaborative environment.
Yeah. Well, Sharif is having Wi-Fi problems. I think he's back. Sharif, are you back?
Yes.
There he is.
Frozen? Oh, wait.
Oh, we can't hear you.
You can't hear me. Yeah. You? I will log off and come back again. And if not, David will help you.
If you want me to explain Sharif's audition process,
What was it like?
It was rather embarrassing. He came up to me and said, Tim, you're one of the most talented people I've ever met. Can you please? You were there, Matt. Yeah. And he said, please. He also said, you're really good looking, like Matt, too. And Tiffani was there. In fact, he said, all three of you are incredibly talented and good looking. Can you please get me on the show? And I
they lie.
Come back. He'll come back. He'll be okay.
Tell
everybody that got so many letters.
Though I'm wearing a suit up top, I'm actually wearing shorts.
Look.
Yes.
Yeah, baby.
I'm wearing slippers. And yes, I can still do this. No, sorry.
Yes.
Well, why not?
We got some letters we want to read.
So, yeah, we've gotten fan letters from all over the place. And this one is from Austria, and especially because this one has been in the news because of a certain, I guess, Instagram or Twitter exchange, Matt Bomer. And this one's from Austria. Hi, my name is Suzanne. I'm from Vienna, Austria. I want to ask, how sure, this is, of course, her English. I don't think it's her first language. But she said, I want to ask how sure it is that White Collar is having a season 7 or 8. Are there already more precise plans and or dates for shooting? When could we expect a resumption of the series? She is very determined.
Three times.
Over and over again. She said, all of you are doing a wonderful job. Love and greetings from sunny, cold Austria. So,
First of all, I want to thank everybody who's watching around the world. For people where it's 3 a.m. or if it's, you know, the beginning of your day or the end of your day, thank you so, so much for joining us. One of the best experiences getting to be a part of this show was getting to interact with you and meet you all from all over the world. I just talked to Jeff Easton this morning, who says hi to everybody, the whole cast, and to everyone, all the fans as well, and sends his love. Look, there's nothing I would want more than to be on a set with this group of people again. There are real conversations happening. There seems to be a lot of excitement about it. What form that takes and how it plays out and whether all the creatives involved can work it out and make it happen is yet to be seen, but we're all really optimistic and hopeful.
Okay, we call that a non-answer, but I appreciate it.
But it's an answer, though. I would say so many of the emails and comments that we read before tonight's show, they literally almost all say what a great chemistry you guys have and how clearly it comes across the screen how much all of you love each other.
Oh, we were actually very sad when it ended. This was not, you know, this was not one of those jobs we were like, we're going home and we're done. No, we were actually quite sad.
Matt, by the way, there's a panic attack because you are not as loud as the others. And
I'm using my teenager's headset microphone.
I would move the microphone closer to your mouth because it's nonstop comments that you're not
is
loud.
Is better?
Actually, I think that is better.
It's a little bit better.
Better, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes.
That's good.
Could you hear me? So
should we start over?
I don't have to repeat everything I said, do I?
Sort of.
No.
Okay, please come back.
Bring on Sharif, though.
Doggo, I don't even know what. Oh, the doggy. Wait, what? Tim, who's the dog?
What? That's Chance. Come here, buddy. Come on. This is Chance, who is our great Dane.
Oh, my goodness.
He's look at that big mug. Okay, we think Sharif is back. We're a nervous wreck. Will it work? Will it not work? Sharif, what do we think? Sharif?
No.
Girl.
Oh.
Okay, look. David Cassidy.
Wait a minute. I'm pretty good at reading lips. Sharif is saying.
Oh, no, not that. No.
The bit worked once, and now it's funny that the host cut me off. Yes.
Okay, David Katz is going to email you, Sharif, and he'll figure out your audio. So stay tuned for David Katz. Until then, just smile and nod pleasantly.
Well, maybe Sharif comes in the second part of the show, Seth, and we bring.
Okay, yeah.
Second part.
So Sharif, peace out. We're going to be on part two, Smart Thinking from the Husband. Thank you, Sharif.
David, you could bump Willie and put in Sharif because.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just don't work at all?
No, it's not going to help.
Well, that means we need to bring on Willie. So bring on Willie. Willie, you ready?
Where's my BFF?
Willie Garson.
Oh, there he is. Yeah. Take a sip.
Oh, boy.
Cheers, my dear.
Cheers.
I miss you.
Miss you more.
Willie.
Now, Seth, for 1 second, Seth.
Yeah.
You know I love you deeply, like a brother.
Yeah.
But that it didn't get sticky on this show, you've lost your friggin' mind.
Okay.
Because here it is, right here.
Yeah.
I disagree with you, Willie. I mean, look, this is very stuff.
Is it coming?
Yeah. Yeah, and those weren't outtakes.
So subtle. So subtle and real.
So, yep. You're still doing your day job of DJing bar mitzvahs? Because I love
I actually put mascara on today.
Amazing. Amazing.
DJing bar mitzvahs.
I am available for bar mitzvahs. That's what these are for. Yep.
So, Willie, we were trying to find out, we want everyone to say who they play on the show and how they got their gig.
A lot of begging on my part. I had done a show, an episode of a show that shot out of the country for our producers, Fox Studios. And when I got back, they said, we're making a companion show to a show called Burn Notice. and we'd love for you to read for it. And then they really made me jump through hoops, a lot of hoops. But I wanted it really badly. I really felt like this guy. And I know that an executive who shall be nameless stood up at my last audition after I left the room. And I'd come off a somewhat successful cable show about women. And he got up in the room and said, listen, we have all these guys, but Willie is like a warm blanket for the audience. So let's give them that blanket. So that's apparently how I got the part.
Hey, Willie, are you?
That's very true.
What show did you come off that you're being so mysterious about?
Something about four women in New York.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway.
Slutty. Really slutty.
I'm out. I don't know why the mystery.
Yeah. It doesn't. Willie, you were slutty, but not the women.
No. Right. I was the women. By the way.
Oh, you have a question about the stuff on your walls. So what's happening on your walls? All the stuff.
Oh my God! So here is here's our beautiful. This is our beautiful Diane, who we miss a lot. Amazing. We love her. And then this is our last season. They gave us this amazing poster for the show.
So and what's this sketch above?
Willie.
That one? That's called Blue Man. Amazing artist. John Huck. Amazing artist here in Los Angeles.
Okay, so someone, by the way, just said, hold on, all these great comments.
Yeah, thank you.
We have so many crazy fans. Oh, yeah, this. So sweet. My sister and I binged the show when quarantine first started. We cried so hard at the scene in the morgue in season 6. By the way, spoiler alert, acting and chemistry 100%.
Yeah, and to that point, there's been a number of people who've written and said the same thing. This one's from Kieran. Myself and my family watched all 81 episodes over the last 6 weeks. And thought it was fabulously distracting from the grim realities of lockdown.
This is like quarantine watching.
So everyone, thank you to everyone of White Collar. So I thought that was really nice.
It's been a big quarantine show for sure. Like we can tell.
You never know in general. I mean, when you're doing a show like this, you're not sure who's watching. And I've been shocked over the years, the people who've reached out to me. I've had people almost run me over as I'm trying to cross at crosswalks. Or people will tell me they've been going through an illness and the show got them through that. So it's just, it's always great to hear that. And I hope that it is giving people comfort at a time like this.
It is. We've said this before, but there's something about this show that's multi-generational.
Totally true.
Younger kids can watch it and maybe think they're getting away with something by watching it, but they're really not, because in the end, it's a show about people taking care of their loved ones. It really is, and a cat and mouse game.
Have your kids watched you guys? I think you all have kids, right? Have they watched this?
My kid was on it. My kid did an episode.
Yeah, he did. Both my kids were extras.
That's right. Your kids were in it too. That's right.
My one daughter, I actually was pregnant in season 1, so my kids were very little, literally.
What about you, Matt? Your kids are too young, right?
They're a little on the younger side. They haven't really gotten into binging it yet. I'm hoping they will at some point. Right now, our twins just turned 12, so we decided it was okay for them to start watching The Simpsons. And so that's been going on like crazy in our house.
And after The Simpsons. And obviously, Matt, they're studying hard for their bar mitzvah. Obviously.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Okay.
Mosey.
Which you'll be DJing.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Hold on. I'll finish with you in a second. I just got to cue this up.
They requested it's raining men. Hey, listen, you have a question.
Oh, can't even see him. It's so big.
Did Mosey know that Neil was really alive? The playing card was a clue, but no one actually knew what happened. Can you tell us your perspective?
My perspective was that the card was supposed to be a clue that Mosey was smart enough to figure out. I will say that I actually made them film another scene because I felt it wasn't clear of Mosey walking down the street with a one-way ticket to Paris sticking out of his pocket. and we filmed it, and they didn't put it in the cut because they thought the playing card was enough. Wow. So yes, Mozzie knew.
But I love, I made them. You like Willie were able to save
Willie was
them.
Willie was meant to be tied.
I made them. I was a lunatic about that. Like this was hours and hours.
Never. You were never a lunatic.
No.
How dare you? How dare you? How dare you? You are cut out of the couples dance.
I keep getting questions. Where's that one about locations?
Oh, locations. Yeah. All right, hold on. There's so many questions. I just printed them all out here. This is from Irene, who, this is a general question, anyone who wants to jump in. Do you have any particular memories of filming in any of your many locations through the years? Any memory of a location shoot that sticks out?
So many.
Oh my gosh.
So many.
I mean, when I came to New York as a completely broke actor. So yeah. I remember in season one, when they were really giving us a nice budget, we would be in these multi-story townhouses on Fifth Avenue and on Park Avenue on the Upper East Side with chandeliers that were three stories high. And as someone who came to New York with no money, getting to see that side of things was just awe-inspiring to me to see how the other half lives. But there were so many. You guys chime in because there were a million over there.
I mean, for Tim, it had to be Yankee Stadium. Tim?
I'm guessing it was. I got to direct one of the episodes, and it took place in Yankee Stadium, which was so exciting. But I think to what Matt was saying, you know, the show showed the different part of New York. It didn't show the gritty stoops or the alleys where somebody was murdered. It was in high-end Sotheby's masterpiece paintings or what have you. So I remember walking in, it was at towards the end of the first season, walking into a mansion, or it was a penthouse actually. And I thought, this must be the last one. This is all there can be in New York. We've hit them all.
Right.
And of course we hadn't, and we went through six seasons of yet finding another amazing three-story apartment that was just like a house. Yeah.
Mine was the ledge. I'm definitely afraid of heights. So of course they wrote an episode where I'm going to jump off a building, and it was on 6th Avenue and 48th Street, and it was the 60th floor or something.
I remember.
And I'm standing on the ledge. You know, I'm all hooked up with cables that you can't see, but it's like that was an unbelievable experience.
Wait a minute, Willie. Did they know that you were scared of heights?
Yeah, was it passive aggressive?
Is it like amazing rage?
They thought it was hilarious.
They thought it was funny.
It was hilarious. Yeah.
Why don't you get like a stunt double?
Well, up until, you know, they use a stunt double until they can't, but I'm very hard to match. I mean, often, you know, Louis Anderson is in Vegas all the time, and like it's hard to get the right, you know, look.
Wait, I want to go back to the mansions. Did you guys ever meet any of the owners of those places? And were they like, please?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
One of them was a big skincare magnate.
That's right.
Yeah. And I thought, I'm in the wrong profession. We got to start making some.
Oh, that was Bob Almay.
Robbie
David Pons.
You guys ever allowed in those mansions to use the bathroom, or was there like a porta potty in the kitchen?
Oh no, they let us use the bathroom.
Yeah, they would let us.
Oh, yeah. The tricky thing, we got to shoot, one of the other amazing locations was we got to shoot on the very top of the Empire State Building.
Amazing.
I got to shoot the incredible Hilarie Burton, which was incredible.
Like literally the crawl space. The crawl space on the top of the Empire State
Building. They don't allow a lot of people up there.
No.
And I knew it was special because halfway through filming that day, Adam Sandler and his family walked through and they were being given like a... It's Uber celebrity. Hi, Hilarie. How are you? Hilarie is there. I'm talking about when we were at the Empire State Building and Adam Sandler's family came through halfway through the day.
It was cool. Everything so they could go on a tour. Yeah. We're not filming a show or anything with light going down. Don't mind us.
They were lovely, by the way.
They were
That's right.
Jeffrey makes fun of me all the time. My husband makes fun of me because I tell the Empire State Building story all the time. And he's like, yes, yes, we know. You're welcome. Yeah, I feel good about it.
You guys are like 1,000 feet up in the air where the winds are like 55 miles an hour. And I've never seen more shellacked, perfect hair.
We had the most amazing hair and makeup team. Truly. Oh my gosh.
And they more or less stayed with us the whole run of the show. They were like family.
Yep. It
had to be a helmet because there was no room to touch up. So they just shellacked everything in the morning and it stayed.
No, I've never seen anything more sturdier. Here, look.
Hey. The first time we kissed, I realized that I don't want anything. Except you. And now I'm asking if you'll go on one more adventure with me. Sarah Ellis, will you marry me?
Wow. Hey, listen, my son is here because he's obsessed with Seth.
You hey, Josh. Hey, Josh.
Radio.
Hey, Josh, are you a musical theater kid?
Gus?
Yes.
Oh, Gus. How old are you?
How old are you?
10.
He and Tiffany's baby were born at the same time. So we raised babies together.
We talked about a lot.
I love it. A lot of stuff. Hi, Gus. Have you played any roles in school yet?
No.
No, but what's your favorite show?
My favorite show? Like,
just one.
What show specifically?
Like a Broadway show.
Broadway show, not TV show.
Specifically, come on.
Okay, I would say Beetlejuice, probably.
Beetlejuice
is
a big thing. Yeah, the
kids love Beetlejuice.
You just made his life. You made his life. He loves you.
Oh, that's so sweet. Gus, you still got it. All right, wait. You're coming back. This wasn't really your segment.
But we couldn't resist.
We couldn't resist. But we're gonna bring out.
I'm having fun watching.
Love you, Hilarie.
So wait there. We're gonna bring you back. Now we're bringing on someone from the Trevor Project who actually, I think, runs it. What is his name?
Yes, he's the CEO and executive director.
It is Amit Paley.
Amazing.
Hey, Amit.
Hi. Amit.
Hi. Hey, Amit.
So don't forget, you can donate tonight. Trevor Project is a really long word. Tonight, go to starsinthehouse.com. Starsinthehouse.com. You're going to get a receipt, then forward it to starsinthehouse2020@gmail.com. And then I'm going to send it to Matt. I'm going to put that back.
But otherwise, if you're watching this, like a lot of people will, after the fact, go to thetrevorproject.org/startsinthehouse and donate.
Correct. So, me, tell everybody what the Trevor Project is.
Before I start, I just want to say thank you so much to Matt, to both of you, to the whole cast for raising awareness about the Trevor Project and our work. We are the world's largest suicide prevention and crisis intervention organization for LGBTQ young people. And we provide support 24/7 for LGBTQ youth who are in crisis.
Literally 24/7. So people can call any time of day.
So I mean, how has the Trevor Project been impacted by COVID-19?
We've been dramatically impacted because LGBTQ youth have been so dramatically impacted by COVID-19. Our call volume, and we operate a 24/7 phone lifeline, but we also operate 24/7 text and chat lifelines as well. And young people via phone, text, and chat have been reaching out at dramatically higher levels than we typically see, at times more than double our normal rates. There are just so many young people who are trapped in homes and with families that are not supportive and not affirming of who they are. That might be college students who are forced back into the closet so that they can be back with their families and not be afraid of being thrown out of the street. They might be middle and high school students who they had a source of support there. They might have had one teacher or one friend or GSA, and now they're with families and those sources of support are just cut off from them.
What is the number that people should be texting or calling?
So if you want to reach out via text, the best way to text is you can just text Trevor or start to 678-678. You can also find the whole range of resources on our website, www.thetrevorproject.org, because in addition to our 24/7 crisis services that young people can reach out to, we also operate a safe space social networking site called Trevor Space, which has also seen dramatically higher rates of young people around the globe reaching out. That's our one program now that's international. And we also offer resources if people just want to see videos or read about our coming out guide or how to take care and be supportive of trans and non-binary young people. We have all those resources and sources of support on our website and on our social media channels as well.
And Matt, how did you get involved with Trevor Project?
I've been aware of their work for years. I had seen that short film many moons ago that led to the formation of the organization, if I'm correct. And I remember when I first heard about it, just wishing that I had had something like that as a kid, because growing up in semi-rural Texas, I imagine this is a time when I would be feeling extreme loneliness and needing somebody who I could really reach out to. So I think the fact that we're able to have an organization like this now where youth can reach out and have someone to talk to and listen to them and help them through whatever they're going through is invaluable.
I love it. All right. Well, you know, now we're going to donate on the bottom, trevorproject.org/stars-in-the-house. Thank you, Amit.
Was there anything?
Thank you, Amit.
Anything else you want to maybe advise people who can't give, you know, donate today, but maybe how they can help people that are LGBTQ in their lives during this time?
Young people.
Yeah, young people.
Yeah, thanks for raising that, because as we said, there's so many young people who are in situations where they don't have supportive people around them. For adults who are watching, or even for young people who are watching, if you can make sure that you are taking steps to show your support for LGBTQ youth, that might be on your social media channels, but that might be if you know people in your life, sending them an email, a text, just reaching out to check up on them. They might be in a really difficult situation, but letting them know that regardless of the people who are physically around them, that they are connected to someone who cares and knows that LGBTQ young people are beautiful and that they are deserving of love and respect. And most importantly, that they are not alone. So if you can let them know that, and also let them know that they can always reach out for help, that if they're somewhere where they are physically isolated, that doesn't mean they have to be socially isolated, that they can reach out to friends, family, chosen family, or the Trevor Project, which, as I said, is always here for them 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
I love it. That's so great.
Thank you
for having us, Amit. Thank you so much for letting us help you guys.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for raising awareness. We're so grateful. Again, to all of you for what you do and to be bringing attention and hopefully funds to support our work at this really, really critical time.
Donate everybody. Donate, people. Donate. Yes, please. It can be a dollar. It can be $1. Doesn't matter. Yes. Donate.
Thank you.
Thanks, Amit.
Okay, so now we're going to start part two. So, Willie Garson, you can hang out, but I'm taking you off camera. So maybe
be prepared. You know, he might bring you on at any time. Yeah.
Maybe you'll get a bus mitzvah gig. So peace out. Tiffani, stay around. Maybe I'll take you back. I'm helping. Then we are going to bring on.
I know, right? Close up.
I know. We're going to bring back Sharif and pray for the best. Sharif, anything?
Hey, can you hear me?
Yes,
Sharif! Yes, and then we're going to bring on Marsha.
Oh.
Yay!
Yes.
What? I'm with Marsha. Cheers. I miss you.
You too.
Hilarie, my only issue is, why are you in a crypt? It's so dark.
Listen. Gus is like turning a flashlight on her.
Yeah, she has a baby. She has a little tiny one. She has to be
She's
quiet.
Not even tiny anymore. She's a monster. But
I know.
Sit on top of my router because I live in the middle of the country. Like, there's cows all over the place. There's no service here. So I'm using like the cell hotspot on my phone, and I'm sitting on top of a router. That's what you get, guys.
How is that, sitting on top of a router?
It's not fun.
Only Tim.
But for you guys, I would do it.
So, Marsha, how did you get the gig?
I was there the day that Tiffani tested. I tested that day. I did an audition, and then they brought me into this really small room, and Tim was there. And it was a really small room. Like,
it was.
All the execs were, like, sat, scrunched up together, like, they couldn't afford a bigger space. I don't know. Anyway, and so we were all together in that room, and I read with Tim, and it went really well. I was super nervous. And then, and Tim, I always remember this, Tim. When I go to auditions now and I'm nervous, I always remember that Tim said, I said to him, I was so nervous that day. Could you tell? And he was like, no, you couldn't tell at all. And so I use that in life, like just to remember, like, you were so nervous that day and Tim couldn't tell. So
I couldn't.
And then when I was going back to my car, I bumped into Tim in the parking lot. Yeah. Which is super awkward. Like, you know, hi, yeah, we did that thing. You can't really talk about it because you're like, what are you going to say? So I was like, good luck with it. You were kind of serious, Tim. Yeah, good luck to you,
Tim. I had to be because I knew all the positive things that they said. And I knew that this thing could, it looked like it was going your way. And so
know how that can go sometimes, right?
Exactly. Right. And so I thought, no, I gotta stay reserved because if the good news comes, it will come as I expected it to.
Yeah. And it took ages for the news to come.
Oh, yeah, for yours, it took forever.
But they took a really long time, like weeks and
I don't
weeks,
know why.
I feel like.
I don't know why.
I think I got the job in July, and we didn't start filming the pilot until after Thanksgiving,
December.
Right?
Yeah, whoa. December. Yeah. It was December because I flew from New York where it was snowing. It was amazing. My first winter in New York, back to England for Christmas. Yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm mystified by your American accent is so good. I don't understand why Brits can do television, but the most amazing.
It is good, isn't it? Yeah.
It's shocking. So wait, Matt, you couldn't pull off a British accent to change the character.
I didn't say, I gave them every region, Seth.
You did.
I am trained in phonetics. I speak with distinction.
Edith Skinner would have been proud.
I gave them options. That's what I learned. Don't give them options, Seth.
No.
Don't give them options.
So Hilarie, I know we're waking you up. Talk about your audition. And first of all, tell everybody who you play and then talk about your audition.
Yeah, I play an insurance investigator named Sarah Ellis, who was brought in to kind of rock the Neil Caffrey boat. I had given birth to my son 3 months earlier, so it was my first audition back, and I was super nervous about it. And I went and auditioned in LA and then didn't hear anything, so figured I didn't get it. And so I went to New Orleans where my husband was filming a movie. And all of a sudden I got this very like frantic phone call. You have to be in Manhattan. You have to go to the studio and meet with Matt. And there were a couple other chicks and we all had to like share a dressing room and it was very
uncomfortable. Ooh.
Hilarie, do you remember that we met that day? You were in makeup, and we were shooting, and you were in makeup, and again, you didn't seem nervous at all. You seemed so, like, I was like, this trick is so cool. Like,
guys, I was so excited to, like, not have a baby attached to my chest for 5 minutes, because I flew in that morning, and then I left as soon as the test was over. Marsha, you and I had met at a photo shoot years before for, like, for when we were on some Las Vegas show, and I was on Las Vegas show. So yeah, you were my ally. You were my safe space. You were my sign. It was all going to work out. And it did. It was fun.
I have a terrible memory. We probably had this conversation already. Have we had this conversation already?
Listen, I locked eyes with Bomer, those beautiful blue eyes, and it was easy. I loved him.
You were amazing. Yeah. It was. Never a question. It was Hilarie B's job.
Mm-hmm. Matt, before I forget, get your iPhone. We're getting so many donations, and we haven't even read any yet. I just sent you the first list. But we have, like, nonstop donations. These are just some.
Give us money.
I had it on airplane mode out of respect to all of you, so hold, please. Did you text me or email me?
I emailed you.
Okay. I can't believe you don't have my – ooh. Oh, hey. Am I supposed to read all these folks?
Yes, please.
Lori, thank you so, so much for your donation. I'm not going to read the amount they donated because unless they want me to.
Well, you can read their messages.
Okay, I'll read your message. Susan, thank you so much for your donation. She says, please ask Matt Bomer if Netflix will still be filming Boys in the Band. Saw it on Broadway and it was amazing. Thank you so much. We have filmed it. We filmed it last summer. It's likely going to come out this fall. Stay tuned for that. There should be some news on it relatively soon. I love all those guys. It was a dream experience on Broadway. We had a great time on the film too, so I really hope you like it. Krishna, thank you so much for your donation. I love you, Neil. I'll speak on behalf of Neil. I love you too. Lori, doubling up here. Thank you, Lori. I'm assuming it's the same Lori. She spelled it L-O-R-I. Adria, this is in honor of Natalie Zhao. Thank you so much. This is for you, Natalie. Crystal, thank you. Mikey, thank you. Irene, thank you so much. She says, thank you so much for doing this to all of us. Thank you so much for being here. Usha, thank you. Ginny, thank you. Joshua says, we love you guys. We love you too, Joshua. Kate and Dan, Brittany, Zoe says, hey, guy, so happy to help. We're happy that you could help. Christo, love the Trevor Project, knew of it for years. Thanks for all of your hard work. Thank you, Christo. Carly, thank you so much for doing this. I love the Trevor Project and White Collar. Happy to contribute. Thank you so much, Carly. Jennifer, Scarlett, Beth, Amy, Jesse, Tony, Madara have all given money. We thank you so much for contributing. Every little bit counts. Thank you so much. And everybody out there, if you can, please give. Even if it's just a dollar, I know they could use this support right now.
Ah, thank you, Matt. Shereen, you're so excited. Your microphone finally
works. Your mic works. So now the focus is on you.
Yeah, start from the beginning.
Shereen.
So the irony is now James and Seth, I can't really hear you guys. But I'm going to assume that you asked me what character I played. And what was my audition process? So,
good assumption.
Jones, and it was myself and Agent Berrigan, with Agent Burke trying to wrangle Caffrey at every turn. He was always into something, so that was always fun. but I'm a little jealous of the audition stories because I don't have one like that, actually. I knew Jeff Easton from a previous project we had done some years before called Hawaii. And the truth of the matter is, I think the deal was sealed on Larchmont here in Los Angeles. I came to him and I said, Jeff, I need a job. And in that moment, I was like, hey, listen, whatever you got, whatever you're working on, listen, you need a personal assistant on this new gig you're doing. And to his credit, Jeff Easton said, nah, man, you're too good of an actor. We're gonna figure out how to bring together a lot of different roles that would have been one-offs into one. And that's how Agent Jones was created. And so I'm hearing all of these bumping into folks' audition stories, and I'm like, yep, it was just me and Easton on Larchmont.
He just got a straight offer, guys. No big deal.
You didn't have to audition.
But you know what?
It
was one of those moments, though.
You're too good an actor.
He is.
It was one of those moments, though, where I realized yet again how important being a decent human being on any set you work on is. You know what I mean? Because if I had been on the set of Hawaii, even as the, you know, I was the second lead with Michael Biehn being the first from Terminator fame. But if I had been someone difficult to work with, that moment would never have happened. So I always thank Jeff, you know, and look back at that moment as like, wow, you kind of, you know, you helped a brother from having to fly back to Chicago. So, yeah, it was cool.
So wait, you still can't hear us, right? Can't hear us.
What's that, James?
Can you hear any of us?
Can you hear us at all?
No, I can hear the cast. I can hear Tim, Matt, Hilarie, and Marsha, but I can't hear you.
You asked me about Operation Smile. Exactly.
They want to know about Operation Smile and your involvement with Operation Smile.
Oh, yeah. You know what? It's a great organization. It's an organization that goes around the world. It's a global organization that helps folks that are dealing with cleft issues. And I don't know if you know, it's in the lip area, typically the nasal cavity area. And my wife and I both were, and still are, not to as much of an extent at the moment, but very involved with attempting to raise awareness and raise money. I had an opportunity to go to Quito, Ecuador some years back and see up close and personal what these doctors who volunteer their time, by the way, it's one of these those organizations where 90% of the funds, 95% of the funds go directly to the folks who need it. And to see up close and personal, to see the patients they help, I literally held in my hand a little baby that had just had the surgery, and to see the tears in the mother's eyes, well, I was sort of the middleman. It was from the doctor to me to the mom. And just to see, she was probably thinking, what are you giving my child to him for? I don't know. But to see the tears in her eyes was just, it was really impactful. It was really impactful. So you know, I'm really big on helping human beings. so even this, you know, this project, having heard Ami speak briefly about this Trevor project, it just, you know, it fills my heart. It's just because people are being helped in their greatest time of need. So,
is that, ask him if that's where he celebrated his birthday in Ecuador. Ask him, yeah.
What was did he say about Ecuador?
Did he celebrate his birthday down there?
Did you celebrate your birthday in Ecuador?
Somebody must have been doing some research.
Google.
Somebody must have been doing some research. Yeah. No, actually, I did. And it caught me off guard. And, you know, I have some video footage.
What, your birthday? Kinda, isn't it the same day every year?
What's that? I didn't hear you. What'd you say? I think you made a crack about it being the same day every year. Yeah, I know my birthday the same day every year. But I didn't realize that they were going to celebrate it with me. And so they really did. They rolled out the red carpet, had a really big cake, and, you know, about 50 to 60 people that I had sort of been traveling with in and throughout Quito at the time kind of gathered around at this restaurant and sang a brother happy birthday. So yeah, it was a very cool moment.
Well, here we go.
Yeah, that's cool.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Don't ask me what I was wearing on my head.
You used to wear that hat all the time.
Listen.
It was cool once.
But at least I felt cool in the moment. It looked kind of ridiculous.
You look cool. No, you look cool.
No, you earned it.
You look cool.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Hey, Hilarie, we got a question from a fan for you.
Okay.
Do you think that Neil may have been the love of Sarah's life? And does Sarah hold out any hope that Neil may turn up in London?
Ooh, honey, it has been, what, a decade? Probably. I feel like Sarah has probably frozen her egg and has, like, really established herself in London with like a beautiful like brownstone and close to like a garden that they could go for walks in, something really like Notting Hill. She has set everything up because she knows he's a little bit flighty. So creating a warm home environment is important. She'll do all the hard labor and then he gets to just show up and look handsome.
Okay, hold on. I want to ask Matt something. Just reminded me, Matt, what was it like having to wear that stupid leg thing? Were you wearing it even though people couldn't see it, just to be a character?
Oh my goodness!
This is a huge question.
I mean, it is and it isn't. But I hope I don't bore everybody to tears. But no, it was something that had to be applied every day. My dream was that somehow they would figure out a way to, you know, first season I wanted it on my leg no matter what, if it was in the shot.
I knew it.
I was so into it. And I was hoping that at some point they'd figure out a way to make it my mic pack as well.
Yeah.
They never figured that out. That would have made so much sense, right? Anyway, there were several different iterations of it. None was more comfortable than the other, except for the first one was so
I remember one time they were like stapling it together and my leg was rubbed like bloody.
Yeah, you were chafing. Had red spot. It was.
Yeah, there was blood involved.
I saw a lot of blood.
I saw one clip where it maybe wasn't so secure.
Wow. That's going to hold me.
That was that was almost a daily occurrence at one point.
It was, and so any of the tension that you saw on her face was not because of the scene. It was please stay clipped on his ankle. Come on,
fell off.
We got to get this shot, please.
Yeah,
Marsha, did you feel like a responsibility to represent lesbians, because there are not that many characters on TV that are lesbians?
Yeah, I did actually, and I was happy to do it. I loved playing Diana. Oh. I loved that she was, Tim just gave her because that was his work wife. And and I loved that we got to see that side of her life in her relationship with Christy. You know, I was very surprised when I got pregnant in real life. I didn't think for one minute they were going to write it into the show, because I didn't imagine that Diana, you know, obviously Diana couldn't accidentally get pregnant, right?
Yeah.
She would have to make a conscious decision and make a choice to do that. And so I was really surprised and delighted, actually, when they wrote it into the show. I loved playing Diana.
So you didn't suggest that to them?
I did not. I assumed I was going to spend the season with, you know, like Claire Huxtable carrying boxes. Every time Felicia Rashad was pregnant, she would carry boxes around, you know? Laundry, that wouldn't quite work
Claire Huxtable. Diana.
But yeah, my thought.
You know, even though I know you were a lesbian on the show, I still managed to find this.
I would have broken out of prison to see that.
Barrow has a key.
You know, I'd say get a room, but...
What if he works for Barrow?
I know who he is.
He's worth a try.
I tell you what, this is the first time I've worn makeup in about 7 weeks. And honestly, it looked, oh my gosh, Diana was so glamorous.
Yeah! Oh, she's beautiful. She was. She was.
What did she? Diana.
Yes.
I love that scene.
A drop for Diana.
Oh, great scene.
I'm there.
Diana was the coolest. Diana was the coolest. She really was.
I really. I mean, is she dead? She's not real. I love playing Diana.
Ironically, I think I made out with every woman on the show, but none of the guys.
That's weird.
That's unfair.
Did we actually
time.
There's time. There is time.
Episode season 7. Okay, everybody keeps asking, what's your favorite episode? So I feel like everyone has to sort of answer that. Favorite moment, favorite episode. Tim, you want to go first?
Oh, gosh, you can't do that. It's really difficult, 81 episodes. But I will say this. There was not one moment, there was not one episode that was unfavorite. It was every single one, every single moment, I never didn't look forward to get it going on the set, ever.
That's a nice answer.
Tim, do you remember we had this conversation? We had it a few times, but standing in the bullpen, and we were looking over it, and we said, it doesn't get any better than this.
I sure do.
I think about it all the time. One day we'll get kicked back out there when the show is over, and you know, and the security of this beautiful show and these beautiful people.
Oh, yeah. And Marsha's speaking to something else, that there was this whole culture, in addition to what was on our set, which was amazing. But in the FBI room, there were all these extras that were obviously much more than extras. As we all know, if you shoot with a bunch of extras background for a long period of time, we got to know all of them. So it was, and they were great at their job. So it was a huge familial experience. It's like doing a really long play, like a long run of a play.
Yeah.
Maddie, what about for you? Favorite episode? Or
I agree with Tim on everything he's saying. Everyone felt great. It never felt like we were working ever. It was always a joy to come to work. I will say, and you don't really realize how lucky you are until you leave and you go to other sets.
Yeah.
And you realize, oh my God, we really had something special. And we knew we had something special, but I'm constantly reminded of it, I guess. Not that I haven't been on other great sets. They've all been great, just not quite the same. There was the end, the very last scene we shot of season one. This is the first time I'd never had a day off in season one. And the last scene we shot was you and I at the airport when we saying goodbye at the hangar when Kate's plane explodes. And we literally had like one take to do it because a blizzard was coming. Do you remember the blizzard in New York in the winter of 2009 when there were like taxi cabs in the middle of the street? So that was coming in, and they literally called cut, and this snowfall started. And it was just this beautiful ending to kind of a fairy tale experience. And then we went back to the studio, and the network came and announced they were going to pick it up for another season. It was just such an incredible day and a feeling of job security that I'd never had before. And just like, oh wow, these people are going to be my family for a while.
So sweet. Can someone ask Sharif since he can't hear us?
Hey, Sharif, what was your favorite scene? What was your favorite scene to shoot or episode?
Having heard everybody chime in, you know, again, I think to echo Tim, like it was a good time. I enjoyed it. I think two popped into my head, though. There was one episode where Marsha and I went undercover as husband and wife. And
I was going to say that.
And it was just one of those episodes where we got to play like nobody's business. Like and it was fun, whether we were in the van or...
the van.
I just remember it as being a lot of fun. The other episode that came to mind quickly, Matt, I don't know if you remember, there's a scene that you and I did. It was an episode that happened to focus on the Agent Jones character. I mean, it was an episode where I got to be decked out in a naval uniform.
Yes.
I got attacked in my apartment, and I'm fighting with plastic pans and things of that nature. And Matt and I had a scene in that, and interestingly enough, our characters never really had, I think until that moment, an intimate exchange. Mm-hmm. And I remember being like, wow, this is a really cool moment. Because the Jones character, I was sharing. I was a little bit more exposed and vulnerable than I am, you know, decked out in a suit and tie, in the FBI. So right off the top, those two, just bring good memories to me.
Oh, wow.
What about, hold on, Tim, I'm going to extend you for a moment. I'm going to bring back Tiffany.
Tiffany,
ready? What was your favorite episode, Maman?
Oh, my gosh. That's so hard. I have so many. I mean, I did like the ones that I got to go outside of the studio, which never happened for me.
Weren't you kidnapped at all, you know?
Wait, what's that, Hilarie?
Weren't you kidnapped? So many.
That was a good one. That actually got to come out of the studio for a moment. The wife got to do something. Yes, that was actually quite fun. It's really hard. I mean, I have so many memories because that chunk of time for me was huge. Like Hilarie as well. When I first started that show, I had never done a show outside of Los Angeles, really. I mean, I'd done movies and things like that outside of Los Angeles, but to actually live somewhere else, being New York City, was huge for me. And I got pregnant at season one. I came back at season two with a 6-week-old baby. Having no sleep and working was something I had never experienced before, but I couldn't have done it with the type of crew and cast that I had. They were so extremely supportive Anytime I had to slip back into my dressing room to tend to my child, they were there. I mean, they really were. Like, I have such fond memories because of so many firsts for me, becoming a first, you know, a mother for the first time, and all those types of things. And I could not love and adore and have so much respect for this cast and crew. Oh,
that's so nice. What about you,
Hilarie? Yeah, you know, it's funny, right? In terms of first, I just remember New York, that entire period, I was dating my now wife.
Right.
I had met her, and there was a period of time where we were secretly dating. And the reason is because she also worked on the set as one of the core background on the show. I had met her initially on another show that I guest starred on, The Good Wife. Mm-hmm. And so it was definitely a memorable 5 years for sure.
Yeah, we all, I mean, I think we all grew up a lot on the show, right?
Big time, yeah.
Yeah, I've been on teen drama for years and years and years, and it was a horrible experience. And I was very hesitant to sign on to do anything ever again. And I was assured by my agent, who also represented Matt at the time, like, no, this is special. This is really lovely. You're going to like this. And so I gambled on it, and they completely retaught me how television was supposed to be and what a set was supposed to be like. And it was healthy, and it was loving and really supportive. And it has set the bar so high for every other job that's come after. I feel bad sometimes because I've been getting asked a lot, like, oh, what's your favorite job you've ever done? And it's always white collar. But it makes the other people I've worked with feel like, oh, good story, Burton. Yeah, but it took care of me in a way that a job had never taken care of me before. Mm. And it just blew my mind that's what work could be.
Oh, wow, that's so positive. True. All right, Hilarie, I'm going to bring on Willie. We only have six. I'm going to take you off for a minute, bring on Willie, and ask. Wait, Marsha, did you talk yet? Marsha, I've got to hear your accent in full Cockney.
It's so sexy.
You know, oh, thanks, Tiff. Like Sharif, I really loved the episode where I got to go undercover. And there was this one episode where I went undercover at a magazine. It was with the wonderful Jane Atkinson. She played this horrendous magazine editor. Mm. Yeah. And so I'm playing Diana, who's American, but Diana is pretending to be British. And there was this one scene where Peter called Diana on the phone. And so I'm talking to him on the phone in an American accent, and then Jane shouts me, and then I go like this, and I do the English accent. And it was just like, you know what, guys? It was a masterclass.
Yes.
I've ever worked so hard, but it was super fun.
All right, we'll
talk
that.
Hey, James and Seth, have you guys asked some embarrassing moments?
Oh, gosh.
Why doesn't that be next? Please wait.
Yeah, sure. Here we go. Thank you.
Yeah, well, a lot of them. Marsha, yeah. You're going to pay. You're going to pay. but, you know, I have to say, I first of all, favorite scenes are really hard because it all ends up being like one long scene over 80 something episodes. I was kind of the utility player in that I had moments with every single person, like great, great episodes with every person. But I always come back to the simplest things. The one that sticks out for me, which will be a surprise even to him, but Matt and I had a scene. You know, we tried to count up once. We had, 600 scenes together or something ridiculous. But we had a scene where we were sitting at Grant's tomb. By the way, Grant is buried there. And we were just sitting and just talking about nothing. It was not about the case. It was about us as human beings connecting. And it was so soft and simple. I think Mike Smith shot it even from behind us, looking out on the fields, you know, around Grant's tomb. And it was my favorite moment because it was the absolute simplest. Just as an actor, you don't get to, like, especially as a character actor, you don't get a lot of scenes that aren't about giving information or moving the story forward or whatever. It was just two guys who are absolute inseparable best friends having a moment to sit and talk. And it was just like the most beautiful moment to me in all of the hundreds and hundreds of scenes. I remember it like it was yesterday. So,
Sharif, embarrassing, go. Ask the nice man. Matt, you can't hear me.
Oh, Sharif, what's your most embarrassing story from set?
Oh, well, you know, I have many, but one of them that prompted me to even think about it was, I think, Willie, you might have been directing this episode, and I think
so. Matt, the whole thing was a bit of an embarrassment. Got it. Good.
What's that?
So the whole thing was embarrassing. Got it.
Right. Good. Completely. Matt, you and I were in I think it was a black BMW or a black Mercedes. Something like that. And
oh, it was a BMW. I was very aware that it was a BMW.
What's that?
I was very aware that it was a BMW. Believe me, it was a BMW.
So I think the BMW representatives were there.
Oh.
And they were watching on the monitor. And Matt and I are driving. Matt's in the passenger seat. I'm in the driver's seat. And we get out of the car. We throw somebody against the hood of the car. But I say, get on the roof of the car. And I literally say it 5 times in a row. So much so that Willie had to come from behind the monitor, walk up to me and say, Sharif, it's not a roof, it's a hood. And I said, no, it's a hood. That's not what I've been saying. No, you've been saying, get on the roof of the car. I just remember Willie being gracious, and Matt was gracious. But I remember walking back after the scene was over and I finally gotten it right, walking back around to the monitors, and the representatives from that particular car company would not look at me.
Wow.
Would not look at me.
That's had so nothing tragic.
There was nothing. It was just dead. Look at them. So that was pretty up there.
And he's never owned a BMW since.
I'd say a lot of embarrassing things happen just shooting in New York. So, sure. You know, like we shot on Allen Street. For those of you who don't know New York, Allen Street has a median in between it. So it's two directions, and then there's a little like garden path with benches and stuff in the middle. What our location manager was not aware of was that every tour bus for Southern Manhattan goes up Allen Street. So we're shooting, and this is personally embarrassing for me, we're trying to shoot, and it was like literally every 30 seconds a bus would come by. And it got to the point where the guy on the microphone on the bus would go, and to our left is Willie Garson from Sex and the City. Like literally, like I'm a statue stand, and we're trying to do the scenes, and it kept happening. I think Strathern was directing, and it just kept happening every friggin' time. And it was like, we can't shoot here. This is a crazy place to shoot. Like, it doesn't make any sense. Willie. Oh, but hold on. I don't want to hog it, but one great moment, Matt and I, Denny Gordon was directed, and we grabbed a shot. It was not set up with no extras planned or anything. And she was like, just roll it. And we were up by Grand Central Station. And Jesus.
That would be my Great Dane. Tim's not the only one who has one.
But it literally looked like Tootsie. It was a street full of Manhattanites.
Yes, I remember.
And we had one shot to get it. Come on, just grab it. Just talk. And that was like embarrassing and wonderful and terrific. I love that. Like
very Midnight Cowboy.
Yeah.
Wow. I feel like I have much more embarrassing moments than those.
Go.
I mean, as a mother, like you're breastfeeding your child and you're like, you know, like there was many moments where cameramen were going, Tiffany, I think you need a moment in your dressing room.
Tiffany, you win.
I think I win.
Yeah. What about you?
Matt, do you remember there was a scene? You may not remember this. It probably wasn't that significant, but I had just, I think I was back 2 weeks from having had Tallulah, having had my baby. And we were stood on this street in Manhattan, and I don't remember what the line was, but I kept feeding you the line and giving you the wrong line, and it made no sense, much like Sharif. And then you get, you,
And then you like, you correct me, you said, no, you know, you're saying whatever, whatever. And I said, I am. And then I just kept saying it to you over and over and over again to the point that at one point you looked at me like, are you crazy? Like, I just...
And now I know, now that I've been in quarantine for a while, I realize that that's basically just my day-to-day life.
Matt, what was your most embarrassing moment?
Every day. I mean, this was a show where it wasn't, not only was it okay to have an embarrassing moment, it was actually kind of encouraged. I think, but I can't think of just one because I think they probably happened every day. And I think there are a lot of gag reels out there somewhere. Your Great Dane just said amen.
Sorry.
There are a lot of gag reels out there.
She's a big fan.
With, you know, 500 of them on them, whether it was Tim and I spontaneously bursting into a song we dedicated to the Statue of Liberty, or like an impromptu dance party on set when I messed up a line. Could be anything.
Yeah.
Could be anything.
We haven't heard from Tim. Hold on, Tim. I'm going to bring on Tim for a second. Tim, what about you, dear? Anything embarrassing you need to know about?
So many, but they weren't embarrassing because you laughed at yourself and with everybody else. But I am reminded of, you know, I kind of pride myself on being athletic and able to toss things and catch things. And I had a heavy set of keys that I had to toss over, I believe, to Sharif across a conference room. And I hit Marsha right in the face, right in the eye. And it's like
my face.
Yeah. And I thought, you know, I thought I'd be cool. And here's what was embarrassing, because the director said, Tim, should we put Marsha someplace else so that you can? No. Come on. No. I got this.
You played college baseball.
Yeah. It was just the next moment. Okay. Action. Kling, right in the face.
And of course, it's amazing.
And
it's
I call up Jeff Thiessen. I said, Jeff, I just did something I feel really bad about. Marsha Thomason, one of the most beautiful people I know. I just hit her in the face with the keys. Beautiful inside and out. Please don't put that on the blooper reel. I feel bad about it. I feel really bad. Rap party comes along. Everybody watches a blooper reel on the big screen. It had to have been the first or second scene that was on there. Just, and they repeated it. They like did the.
You guys, I think we have to wrap up the show. We're devastated.
No, we're going to keep going. We're going to keep going.
I sent you a couple more donations.
I got it. Here we go.
Do it.
So many. Kelly.
Kelly, thank you so much, Kelly. She says, I adopted a kitty from a shelter and named him Mozzie after his character's backstory of having been abandoned. Oh, my gosh, I'm going to cry. And also because he is a loyal sidekick. Love that story, Kelly. Thank you. Baula, I apologize if I'm pronouncing your name incorrectly. It happens to me all the time. B-A-U-L-A, Baula. Thank you so much. She says, hi, Matt and White Collar Cast. Thank you so much for organizing this reunion. Definitely put a huge smile on my face. Thanks also to Stars in the House for all the great reunions taking place and for raising so much money for charity. Yes, yeah. Stars in the House. Yeah. Yes.
Where do you go?
Slater, maybe this is from Tiffany's past. Thank you, Slater. That was it. That was a Saved by the Bell reference. Sorry. That's another reunion you can do later. Slater
says, my God. That's
love
hilarious.
This reunion and this show. We love you, Slater. Udel, U-D-E-L. Do you guys have a better pronunciation?
No.
Udel.
I love the entire cast and I'm just so excited for more White Collar. Question for Willie. Does anyone recognize you from Boy Meets World?
Oh, yeah. There's a whole generation.
Okay. All right.
We'll leave it at that.
Melissa from Canada, thank you so much, Udell. Melissa from Canada says, I actually just saw Hilarie in February at a One Tree Hill convention. She was initially why I started watching White Collar.
Oh, that's sweet.
But then I stayed for the rest of the cast and story.
Mm.
Thank you, Melissa, very much. Tate says, thank you all for supporting the Trevor Project. What they do is so important. Tate, we could not agree more. If you're out there, please call in or write in. Please donate. Go to the website. We need your help at this time. William, please tell Matt Bomer that my daughter Emma thinks she's married to you, so I'm donating $50 as a wedding gift. Yes! All right.
Hey, congratulations.
Emma, it's you so and nice Emma. To finally meet you. I'm so glad it all worked out.
Bravo. It's an arranged marriage.
That's a hot couple.
Love you, Emma.
That's great.
All right, so the final thing I'm going to do is for you, Matt. I always do a little quiz, see if people remember things.
And you can blame
I'm not going to remember anything. guys, you got to help me. I'm not going to remember anything.
Uh-oh.
You did it to the Kennedy Center. I held her for an instant. Hit it.
No. I'm not warmed up. I'm not going to give a discerning Broadway cast a B-minus performance. I'll come back and do that solo.
It's not even high.
But my arms felt sure and strong. Yeah. It only takes a moment to be loved your whole life long.
You still got it. I thought we were
going to
come
on,
Andy. So in conclusion, where do people donate?
That's our dog.
What do you say in conclusion? What?
Where do they donate?
Where do they donate?
You know where to donate. You go online to trevorproject.org/starsinthehouse-whitecollarreunion. Is that right? Did I get that all right?
Stars in the House website, and you can donate there.
That's right. That's right.
You guys were also great. We're going to take ourselves off and
we're going to
say goodbye to everybody.
Okay.
What's going on?
I don't know.
We're saying goodbye.
Oh, we are. But hold on. Hold on. I want to really give a thanks to Matt for organizing it. My dear friend Maddie. Seth and James, you're doing amazing things.
Guys.
I love you both. And I also want to give a shout out to our absolute super fans, like Matt said, around the world, especially to Karina and Rock Isabella, our two absolute super fans.
Yes.
But we want to thank you all for all your support and love. Thanks for donating.
Love you guys.
Thank you guys.
See you soon in person, I hope, so I can give you a big hug and kiss. Thank you, Seth.
Thanks, everyone.
Don't forget.